Today I'm deep in the Rocky Mountains. Guiding me is a legendary elk hunter, Tom Klumper. He has hunted elk all his life, and he has invited me to hopefully kill number 200.
Well, we're over 7 miles in, and it's so remote back in here that elk are watching us walk by them. There's a bull in that group, but he's not very big. You see where the forest has been burnt over 10 years ago, and it still looks like this. On the opposite ridge, you can see all the buck brush coming up and the grasses and new growth. So the elk move in here. It's a cycle of life. When these trees die, then the new growth comes on and the animals begin to forage. Hopefully we kill a big bull. You got a pack team. The key is to keep a balance, because the weight shifts up and down when you're going this rugged terrain. So they try to keep the same weight on both sides of the mule. But ultimately in this rough country, you just can't maintain it. And so every half mile or so, you're stopping and retying.
Today I carry the coveted wilderness tag, and it's here that bulls grow old. They stack the bones tall and wide. I'm hoping for a big one. So I'm excited, and it's a good thing, for the ride to camp was a long one. Day one, we're already in the elk.
Tom's tying off the last horse. We made it to the crest of the mountain. We're at about 9,000 feet. We came up through here in the dark. You can see it's thick, heavy country. And when we crested the hill, a bull opened out here across there. So we're letting everything settle. I'm gonna get the wind right, move in and see if I can call this bull in.
Tom's behind me about 70 yards, cow calling to the bull. I'm moving into position, hoping to ambush the bull as Tom lures him past me.
Put your camera.
It didn't take long before I saw the bull's antlers, and he's coming my way.
Here he comes.
The bull is finally in range. Each year, hunters head west with the high hopes of hearing the lone bugle of a bull elk. The sheer thrill of witnessing him in his glory has long since captivated hunters throughout the centuries. Like most hunters, I cherish the opportunity to pursue these majestic beasts. We will test our will, our endurance, and push ourselves to the limits just to hear the music. Our forefathers hunted elk, and luckily for us, many had the foresight to ensure the future for generations to come. And today we begin again, the hunt for any elk. Don't try to be like me, for I'm old, crazy, and have nothing to lose. Tom's calling is more than he can handle. And the bull, although he's leery, just has to get a little closer. You can tell he suspects trouble, and finally he turns to leave. But he makes a deadly mistake and stops broadside at 35 yards. Today he is lucky. If he lives somewhere else, I'd probably kill him. So we rode deeper into the wilderness, and unfortunately the heat has set in. The bulls have shut up. Everyone but me and the elk, they like the heat. So I sat water hoping that eventually it would pull one near. That didn't work out for me. Two days later, I've had a break. We've heard a bull bugling in the distance. Tom and Clay send me in to hopefully ambush the bull in his bed while they stay back and call. They're trying to keep the bull talking. And the bull keeps bugling, but the closer I get, the thicker the new growth becomes. If I get a shot, it's going to be point blank. The bull is on his feet. I can tell he's headed towards Tom. The closer I got, the thicker the forest became. The bull kept moving closer and closer to Clay, and eventually, I spotted him as he moves through the brush. I tried to stop him, but he was past before I could get the shot.
How big was he?
I couldn't see.
Little did I know, but after he passed me, he ran right up to Clay.
So Clayton sends me around because Clayton gave me some of his experienced advice. You know, I'm twice his age. Matter of fact, the first hunt Tom and I did together, he was a baby. And now he's telling me what to do. So Clayton tells me to sneak around and go in and shoot the bull while he's making him talk. So I snuck around like Clayton told me, but every time he called, the bull would scream and run towards Clayton. So while I'm down there where the bull was bedded trying to shoot him coming through the brush, he runs up and smiles at Clayton 30 yards away.
Yeah.
Big 6x6. But hey, we're having fun, aren't we, Clayton?
Dang right.
Clayton's going to be a great guide, and he already is, and he's working with one of the best right over there. Tom ain't a lot to look at, but he's a heck of an elk guide. That mountain in the foreground is younger than Tom. So if you want to go with experienced people, you're in the right place hunting with San Francisco River Outfitters.
So we're back to sitting on water. I discovered that my guide is probably a better carver than an elk guide. Actually, he's pretty good, but we were having fun no matter what we did. It was obvious they were drinking at night. What else could a guy do but lay down and dream of past hunts? You may recall this one. It was one of my favorites. The spear has hit the mark. Startled by the hit, the bull retreats into the dark timber. But as he runs, the spear slams against trees, increasing the effect of the blades. And in short moments, he is dead.
My camera came out of the... Here, hold this.
Is it recording?
Yeah. This is why spears kill animals so quickly. Because when they go in and that thing runs, hits stuff, it kills him dead, boy.
I'm right behind you.
So look at this tree. This is where my guide, Tomas, over here. Tom, why'd you tie us all up and have us sitting under this tree? You got a death wish?
Well, if the wind was blowing, we wouldn't have parked here. The wind wasn't blowing.
Look up this tree. This is this tree is easily 10 tons, maybe 20 tons. But look at the base of it. It's all burnt out. Crazy.
There's a big spruce tree.
This tree won't make it another year, I bet you. And it's leaning towards my horse.
We're getting delirious. We need to draw blood.
Yeah.
We've had bulls all around us. We just haven't closed the gap yet.
Tom, how many years you been hunting elk?
Oh, since I was 11, I guess, I killed my first bull in Colorado. I'm 77, so what's that?
That's a lot.
11 minus 77 is 66 years.
Yeah, that's a long time, man. Tom got me my first coos deer, and he got me my first mule deer, and my first lion. We got a lot together.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Time to saddle up and hit the road.
That's why we're here.
You may recall this one, on the same ridge, years before.
He's a long ways off, but he answered me. Let's go get him.
The Fox Pro's sweet cow calls were more than this bull could handle. I had cow called, then quickly moved downwind in hopes the bull would try and get my scent. I can see him coming my way. He's moving through the timberline above me. But instead, he has made a beeline straight to where I had last called. As he eases my way, I prepare for the shot. Now he's passing above me, just on the edge of my range. If ever I was going to take the shot, the time was now.
Up above me about 75, 80 yards. I stopped him with a cow call, held over him about 3.5 feet. Whoop! Boof! I got a big one. Yes! Life is good. The marrow of the earth. I'm at the top of the world right now. Yeah, got me a big bull.
So here we are, me and Clay. We're back in the middle of the forest, approximately 17 miles from a road, and we're about 2 miles from our horses, because you can see, if you look down here, if you pan down here, John, you can see that the deadfalls from the fires litter the earth, and it's just too much to push the horses through it. But this area is full of big bulls, and we came in here this morning and we spotted a big bull. It looked like a 350 bull. Two big bulls, yeah.
And we got to the top of the ridge where the bull was, and he had dove over into some new growth that was about 20 feet tall and just tight, you know. So the bull bedded. We left him. Now we're a mile over the top of the ridge down in this valley, and there's a wet creek down here that's flowing. There's elk sign everywhere. But man, the days are long because you hunt in the morning and it's too far to go back to camp. So you just sit around and tell hunting stories in the sunlight for 8 hours in the midday. But it's 3:30 now, and between 3 to dark, sometimes the bulls will open and start bugling, so we're hoping that tonight's the night.
That buzzard circling us, that was a sign.
Good sign when there's buzzards over. I want to kill a big bull, and Clay wants me to kill a big one because he thinks he can get a tip and he can afford a new hat. So, he's not wearing Mossy Oak, he's wearing 1982, what is this, Advantage camo. It's been a little faded. I'm going to have to hook him up with a new Mossy Oak coat, but I'll get my camo on here in a little bit when it starts cooling down. We're having fun though. It's the time of our life. We're glad you could join us.
The days had passed, and on the final afternoon, a bull has opened nearly a mile out. It's now a race till dark. This would be my last chance at Tom's number 200. The bull sounded hot, so we poured the calls to him. And each time he'd bugle, you could tell he was getting closer. I'm set up and waiting for the bull to crest above me, but instead, he's skirting me downhill. He's trying to get downwind to check the call to see if we're real. Now my cameraman is actually closer than I am. The light is fading. If ever it's going to happen, it needs to be soon. There he is, but the bull is leery and he's swinging wide. This is going to be a stretch. The shot looks good, but quickly we cow called to calm the bull. From atop the ridge, I can see that he's leaking a stream of blood from his vitals. The Grim Reaper is closing the curtains.
That was a whopper. Pretty exciting. Pretty big bull. He was screaming his butt off.
That's a hell of a shot, too. With a freaking instinctive bull. Anywhere from 120 to 125.
You sure? All right. I think I pinwheeled him, though.
Yeah, 120.
That's the longest elk shot I've ever taken.
I don't know though. I didn't know exactly where he was, so anywhere from 120 to 125.
All right.
My cameraman just woke up. He likes to sleep. But John's done a good job, so I'm not complaining. But it's the morning after, and we're pretty excited to go get the bull. It's been a cold night, so he kept well. Anyhow, this is kind of the setup. We got a beautiful wall tent here and tarp on the floor. This is kind of the typical look of an elk camp, an elaborate camp, you know, a nice camp. Got a cook tent out back, but Tom does, Tom's been doing this for 50 years and told me he wanted one more big bowl with the bow. And we might have got it pulled off, huh, Tom?
Well, I hope so.
Yeah. So we're gonna have some sausage and eggs celebrate this morning here before we head up the mountain on the horses and drinking some black coffee. I wish I had some of my French vanilla creamer, but fine.
Cowboy coffee.
Cowboy coffee. That's right. Yeah. Tom, how many bulls? You said you drug 199 bulls out of these mountains, and so we're calling one more bull number 200. And it's been a pleasure hunting with Tom. We've killed a lot of stuff together and probably going to kill a lot more. So when we get back, we're going to go find that bull.
Beautiful or what, buddy?
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Oh my goodness.
Look at that. Huh?
It's a good one.
Lung shot.
Oh my goodness. That arrow.
That's all the further uphill they could go.
Yeah, I'm not. My shot perfect. Was a little high. I was about 3 inches off the mark there, buddy. Shot lots of elk and enjoyed every one of them, but you know, there's something about a giant bull elk in all his glory.
I like that whale tail.
Yeah, man, he's God really painted, it's like a painting. You know, you couldn't think of a more beautiful thing to create. Gosh, so wonderful.
Yeah, that whale tail is probably a good 25 inches.
Wow, that was fantastic. You know, that was a long shot, but every morning before I go to the editing studio or go into my office, I'll step out on the porch, and I got my bow that sits inside the door there, and I got a target at 55 yards, I got another one at 75, I got one at 100, and then I got one at 125. And I shoot 4 arrows every morning before I go to work. Sometimes I'll go gather them when I get home and shoot them again. And when that bull came out, and you said, "Shoot him, you son of an explicit," I said to myself, well, it's last day and he's standing right where my target usually is. But I misjudged him about 5 yards. I thought he was 5 yards further than he was, and I hit him a little high, but it did him in.
Yeah, but I don't know how you shot. Do that. That instinctive ability you've got is just phenomenal.
Well, if I'd had a pin.
Nobody in the f-ing world can do that.
Well, if I'd had a pin, Tom, I probably would have missed, but.
Oh yeah, shit, you've never used pins.
Okay, this arrow come out down here. Oh, looky here, sticking out. There's the tip of my Grim Reaper right here. The tip popped right out. Okay, so that arrow came in a little bit higher than I like, but at that distance, 120 yards, it's dropping like he shot him from a tree stand, and then it pops out. So I lost about 9 feet of elevation on the shot. But when it popped out and probably took out that side of his lung and the top of this lung. Found the arrow laying there on the ground. Actually, John did. He's filming. And I knew when I found the arrow that this Carbon Express has broke off halfway up the arrow, and there was a little splash of blood right where it was broke off. So I knew his shoulder. If you make that in that crease, if you can get that arrow in there, inevitably, if your arrow's still in the bowl, that shoulder, when he runs, snaps the arrow. And so that was very encouraging to me to see that, but.
Yeah, I was impressed when you found that piece of arrow.
When the old, you know, that green
path of death crosses the sky, and you see it. I mean, I'm like, when I let go, Clay, I just was saying to myself the whole time, hurry up and get there, man. He's gonna run. But I could see the old green path of death following him, tracking the animal, and it was losing elevation, I shot over him, but no, it lost it and it dropped right into the honey hole. Well, hey, we've had a great time here. I know that I'm hunting with some real mountain men, and we just tracked down number 200. Hope you enjoyed the hunt. I know I sure did. Well, on every hunt, I try to get my cameraman in there at some point in time, but after I looked at John's face, I knew the ratings might drop a little bit. I do owe him this much. Hey, what's your YouTube channel?
Oh, it's funny. It's actually the Wild Pursuit.
Wild Pursuit. All right. Well, hey, John's had some success in his life as well in front of the behind the bow and behind the rifle, so check it out, Wild Pursuit on YouTube. But anyway, from all of us here at Relentless Pursuit, hey, we've had a great time, and book you a hunt with Tom Klumpker, because that guy can deliver, man. What a fun hunt we've had, and there's bulls everywhere. All right, thanks for watching.
That's the only thing I know. Just soon die out here in the woods.
The years are behind Tom and I, but together we celebrate one last kill. And whether or not I walk the hills with Tom again, this is one hunt that will last in my mind forever.